Next question.
Okay, I just want to say I'm a professor at RISD. I had just arrived at RISD when we were president, and I was looking around at all these senior faculty being very critical, and I just want to say that your influence was very much felt and has been developed into courses like the one you mentioned, into a new department, which was just founded and announced today, called Computation, Technology, and Culture. And so your legacy is, we are grateful for your legacy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I heard about the art and computation thing, and it's so exciting. But you did it all yourself, so thank you.
Also, thank you for telling such a great story. I really feel that a strong impact, influence. It takes time, but in the end, it's materialized. Yeah. I'm very happy.
Hi, I'm Ethan. I'm at the undergrad. I'm a nurse who's probably the youngest in the room here. MIT has been a really friendly environment for me from making to design to come to science. And this creates a really hybrid learning mode for me. But I'm just wondering, in the real world, when people view at people with hybrid capabilities, and how do people feel about credentials, and you're not from an art background, you're not from a science background, this makes up everything. How does that apply in the real world, and how do you get to go into these like climate sectors, art sectors, without those credentials or backing up and survive in the real world going into this professional area?
So I think credentials are really powerful. They get you into the door. They help to dispel people's bias to think that I shouldn't listen to you. You have to know that after I left MIT my first time, I was in Japan, and I was at a party, and I'm American, and I can't speak Japanese fluently, but I can understand it really well. Because you've got to know, my father was a disciplinarian, so I knew how to say yes in Japanese. That was the extent that I could respond to him. But I was at a party in Tokyo, and I remember there were like people around me talking about me. And they were like, oh, there's that guy John. He's from MIT. He doesn't know design. He'll never make it. So I was like, oh, really? And I love challenges like that. Yeah. It's even like when I went to Silicon Valley, I heard a lot of people say, oh, John knows nothing about how product design works. He'll never make it. I love that. Because you're challenged. So going back to not having credentials, it's easier to have a credential, but if even you have it, no one's going to believe you unless you put it into practice. That's why being a maker is so powerful. And that's why I try to continue to make. It's why I can still code, I can still design, I can do all these things. Am I great at it? Nah, not really. But I'm a good breadth person. Yeah. It's just my philosophy. I want to note that I met the sculptor Igarashi Takanobu when I was young. He was an incredible designer, sculptor. He did the MoMA graphics bag. He was an amazing designer. I visited him one time, and I was in my late 20s. I come from semiconductor simulation. You have to understand. I'm from device physics, chip design, boards. And so I was lost. And so I was like visiting him, and I said, is something wrong with me? And he said, no, you're just like building your career. He said that there's two ways to build that. One way is the Western way, he said. And that's to sort of be really good at one thing. You're building the mountain like this. The other way is the Eastern way, which is you build it so slowly, and it's a very shallow hill. And he said, what is the symbol of beauty in Japan? Mount Fuji. He said, the beauty of being broad is you become like Mount Fuji. The problem with being so focused this way is if one thing is wrong along the way, the mountain falls over. However, people will dispute me on the internet and say, no, what he's saying is that when the mountain falls over, more trees grow, boom. So anyways, take it the way you like. Good. Question. Okay, I read the question.
I wanted to ask you about something that I've been coming across a lot lately, which is the dissemination and publication of powerful information. I'm finding more and more that I don't want to share things that I've learned because they're just available to my enemies, essentially. If you take a look at the way graphic design, for example, has been weaponized to get us to eat things that we shouldn't be eating, how do you control your audience and disseminate your information so that it only helps people that, only benefits and empowers people that deserve it?
I remember one of my favorite moments here in this building is I was having dinner for a sponsor thing, and I was next to Marvin Minsky, and I was talking with Marvin, and Marvin, I'd been here for maybe 6 years or so, and Marvin said to me, "Hey, I've noticed you." I said, "Really? Am I annoying you?" And he said, "No, I noticed that like you had a career before you came to MIT as a professor." And he said that, and because of that, you do things differently. You're already baked and good to go thing. And then I said, "You're the guy, so I thank you for saying that." And then he said something about how one thing he learned is that the whole point of having an idea is to give it away, to figure out if you're good enough to have the next idea. And back to your question, the question Noah was asking was, if I got a good idea, if I give them away, what's going to happen to them? They could be used to the wrong whatever. Yes, and if you're someone who's ideaful, you won't have new ideas if you don't give them away. You'll clutch them like in Lord of the Rings, my precious. And then, you know what happens in that movie. Yep. Next question.
You.
Hi. It's my honor to meet you as well. I'm Jisoo, and I also went to RISD after Boston, and now I'm at Harvard. So my question is, it really touched me when you said we have to make strong cases, justifiable cases for projecting creativity of the world. And it made me think about Professor Kinaleski at RISD, who wrote a book called Storm of Creativity, where she used, given in a digital age where, and then when I went to RISD, what I learned the most is embodying the act of process, the act of discovering through process, and given in a digital age how technology is expediting the process of finding an answer, do you think it's a threat? It could be a threat to preserving creativity, and if so, how do we preserve that act of process with the involvement of technology in today's world?
What kind of design were you in, or art?
I did architecture.
Which one?
Architecture.
Oh, okay, architecture. All right. Not in a bad way. Anyone come from sculpture? Sculpture people? Sculpture. Okay. Sculpture people. Sculpture people. Let's say you're sculpting out of aluminum. Do you want to do it by hand? Or would you prefer to use a tool? Kind of. For those of you online too, try sculpting with aluminum without a stupid water jet cutter. Try cutting that. It takes you forever. Like I milled, so I did this hand thing for 3 months. I like broke my hands, whatever. No, I want a machine. So there are certain things that, yes, as a human, you can do manually, but it just doesn't make sense. So I think the point is that creativity is about having time to think. My favorite example is Orbiting the Giant Hairball, Gordon Mackenzie. It's a somewhat obscure book, but it's a book about creativity. And Gordon Mackenzie was the chief enigma officer of Hallmark. So he was an odd person in a corporate environment. But he has this, like you, he has these weird slides. So these really powerful slides. She's showing, let's say you're a CEO, you're wearing a suit, showing up a cow pasture, you're trying to improve the production of milk. So you go up to cows and say, "Come on, let's make more milk. More milk now." And you're like, "More milk." And he draws a graph. And the graph is the graph of like how long it takes to make milk and how long it takes to express it. I took it as a sort of metaphor for you need time to create. If you can now have that same time and not burrow through a piece of aluminum by hand or the tool, what could you have made instead? Is the question I think I ask myself. For those of you who write code, if you haven't tried writing code with AI, you haven't experienced this new life yet, but it's bizarre and interesting. And for some, they feel threatened. But for some, you feel empowered. I prefer to lean on the empowered side because as a child of the technology revolution, I know that we have to keep creating to find a better path. I think everyone has to go now, no? Oh, 10
more
minutes.
10
minutes. Please feel free to drop off anytime. There you go. Yeah.
Cyrus. Hi, I'm Cyrus.
Hey, yes. Cyrus. How are you? What's Superchain? That's a new brand? Yeah. I forget that?
Yeah, I just wanted to thank you, firstly. It's a really fantastic talk and very humorous, so I really enjoyed it.
Oh, thanks.
I noticed in your trajectory you have a remarkable talent for basically being really on time. You're not too early, you're not late, you're just exactly in the right place at the right time.
Ooh.
So I'm curious if that's talent, luck, skill, some combination of that. Have you ever thought about that?
And then I'm also curious, if let's say you can go back to MIT now, be a graduate student, what would you want to focus on now?
So this question is about how to be lucky. Luck comes with a lot of lack of luck too. People who have ever given me a hard time, I tell them, how many times do you think I had a bad day? quite a few times. It's just a factor of iteration and resilience. I don't think I've done anything yet. I'm curious. I want to do more. Look at Hiroshi. I mean, he got the Conference for Hiroshi Ishii Award, and he's not done yet. That's a lot. Yeah. It isn't that kind of fail fast, fail whatever. You have to understand that failing hurts. Failing is a terrible feeling that either you ingest it and you take it in, or you deny it. I have a lot of it in me. And going back to learning to speak human, it made me so much more human. Those of you who knew me when I was younger know I'm different now. It's because I've been able to experience so much extreme failure that it's made me a better person. It's made me a different person. Yeah, so I wish you much difficult stuff. Super chain.
Yeah. No.
Especially Hiroshi Ishii, look out.
Any more questions?
So I'm Perry, I'm a researcher upstairs in Joe Curtis's group.
Joe P. Yeah, he's also like a magician.
I was also one of Golan Levin's students.
I know Golan, yes. Yeah.
The Media Lab and RISD and all these kind of places, these like creative safe spaces in a way. And it seems as artists and students, we sometimes feel like we're jumping between these spaces. How do we break free of that and actually go and affect? We can have an effect on the world in places like that, but how do we really embark on a journey that separates from that and goes further than that and allows us to be creative and make a leap?
Yeah, our answer is very simple. Capital. No, I'm not kidding. Capital can empower that itch, that curiosity. I think in a place like this, you're able to have the cow moment where you're chewing on grass. But to really turn it to operationalizing, you need capital. And that's why having a business background, a business friend or whatever is actually quite advantageous. Because if anything I've come to deeply respect is people who deploy real products. It's an incredible skill, it requires a lot of teamwork, it requires a lot of lower ego. There isn't a lot of creativity in it per se, but there is team creativity in it. If you think of any like these things flying up there, like you're always in, it's like, that wasn't one person's, I've got an idea in the shower, it's gonna be awesome. It doesn't turn out that way. So teamwork, creativity, capital, that's where I spend my time on.
Hi, I'm from industrial design major. That's my background, and right now I found that schools are canceling or reducing their architecture major or the design major and pay more attention on AI and machine learning. And I just wonder, what's your vision for designers, also creators and artists, what's their future with AI and machine learning? Because also recently I found a debate talking about if human recognition or human recognition is somewhat make a human, but is that a power or our ability of that can be replaced by AI? How artists and designer will be impacted by that?
The first thing I will say is that anyone who's talking about this and not actually writing code doesn't understand it, because it has limitations, it has surprises in it. It's like when you encounter any medium. There was a woman who passed away 10 years ago, maybe, Red Burns. Somebody know Red Burns? I wish you could look her up, but she was an extraordinary person who was different because she had the anti-media lab. She had a less tech, high art NYU center, which still exists, the TP, Interactive Telecommunication Program. And Red's program was one in which people who could never touch technology could not just touch it, but go to the extreme with it. Making in it is so critical. And every time she would greet her first year class, she would give this speech. If you look it online, I have it on my blog. I have a PDF that I posted. But she talks about the Lumiere brothers and how in the late 1800s, they projected a train on the side of a cafe. And the cafe participants ran out screaming in shock at this. The point wasn't for the artist to shock them. It's a new paradigm comes out. Everyone's unsettled by it, but it's people who actually make with it, the makers, not the talkers. I just encourage you make a lot more, get closer to LLMs. Don't stay stuck in the tool layer. All these cool tools coming out, anything with .AI on it, it's cool. But go deeper. It's like working with any material, understand the fibers, understand the properties, and then make a an opinion.
Hi, John. Thank you for your talk. I'm a researcher at Hiroshi's group, too.
Whoa. Did you require people asking questions?
relevant for our group, right now we're interacting through the computer interface, the digital side of the stuff. Do you see a future where tangibility, interacting with AI, we can interact with it more through a tangible format, which is important for us human beings because we live in this physical world?
As long as Hiroshi Ishii is, yes, of course. This question of tangible media be around, look over there, right over there. Yeah. But not only Hiroshi, though, but Hiroshi has created so many people out there. There's so many people that are part of the Hiroshi Fest all the time online, and people have never met Hiroshi. So I think that the vision of tangible media is going to live on quite well. Who's going to depend upon? On you. See that, Hiroshi? Yeah, there we go. Good luck, guys. All right.
I thought that slide was super interesting.
Would you mind telling me your name?
Oh, I'm Johnny. I'm in Kent Larson City Science
Group. Oh, good.
And you had that slide where you're showing kind of compute and cost, and then you were talking about how there was a certain point where the Media Lab had, I don't know, maybe more compute per square foot than anywhere in the world. And I think the world has obviously changed a ton since then. A lot of these ideas, such as IDEO's design thinking and putting artists and designers, engineers, and scientists all together, I feel like is a much more widespread idea. And I think that also, I think, would cause, I feel like, a lot of the Media Lab to think about, okay, so there are less walls between the Media Lab and the rest of the world. What role do you think, or I guess exclusiveness might be the wrong word, but I think that I'd be curious what you think the role of the Media Lab is with a world that is a bit more, or has way more access to some of the same tools that we do.
The thing you're asking, I'm lucky to have met Whitman Richards, because you're talking about it like Media Lab or whatever, you're talking about the world at the same time. The answer is in the world, it's not here. So I would just encourage you to think out there versus here. I think the nice thing about having, I've gone and come back, this is weird. By having been an oscillatory being, I noticed that wherever you are, that's what you think is the most important. And that's the tragedy and the power of an institution. What you're looking for won't be found here, is all I can tell you. So I hope you get out there. Yeah.
I like your last question, because that's exactly why we exist here. What's our vision? Also, how we can share the rest of the world. But also, I think a fear that the people catch up is very good. We have to keep running. So catch me if you can. That's my message to AI or rest of the world. So I think I really focusing about, keep inventing the original new vision, then going ahead is something very important. So I have to really take your best question very seriously. Mm-hmm. They need all the faculty. So thank you. So I'd like to thank you, all your audience, but also how many are online?
People are leaving now, so bye, everybody. Thank you for hanging
but
out.
I'm also scared because registration exceeds 500. Zoom is limit 500, so he upgraded to the more bigger business account. But that's not that. I'm really happy because we could share the excitement which happened in Seattle. So many students came and talked stuff. Now John Maeda came and shared many people watch the streaming, and I think continued a lot of the conversation. So it's really interesting to learn what it means, what kind of influence, impact, or inspiration you got. So we're very happy to receive any message. So hope we can make this video available to the public. Hope we like to keep hearing about your comments, but hope this become a beginning of the conversation to last many years to come. So thanks again to Dr. John Maeda.
Thank you.